Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Finstep Asia Edge Podcast. We're here at GFF Day 3. Exciting times with the Prime Minister walking around. But more excitingly, we have one of India's leading fintech founders and fintech hyperface. We're here with the co-founder and CEO, Aishwarya Jaishankar, who has been in finance for a while, but also been very actively promoting and developing fintech in the region. So, Aishwarya, welcome to Finstep Asia Edge Podcast. Thank you for joining us. Busy time. How has GFF been for you so far?
Oh, it's utter madness, right? Chaos for the right reasons is how I put it. We've been meeting banks, we've been meeting brands, we've been meeting partners. We announced a few partnerships, launches. Team has been busy putting everything together. So it's been fantastic. And of course, Mr. Modi ji was here. Our booth was one of the ones selected. Yeah. We didn't press in, but it was great to even know that we're part of that small list. Yes. So, yeah.
This is well deserved. So, I want to get the audience to understand your entrepreneurship journey.
Sure.
Being in banking, being a career, and then moving on to doing, setting up is not an easy task. So, why did you leave the cushy banking job, as it were, and move into the hard work for being a founder?
But Mushir, before that, you're all our inspirations, right? I mean, the way you've set up and built fintech as a buzzword, right? We all have been doing this. We never had a word fintech 15 years back. So I've been a career banker, but there were 5 years, 2005 to 10, I was in HDFC Bank. 2010 to 15, I was with a startup. In today's world, it would have been called fintech. Then the word didn't exist.
Correct.
But that's when you learn the power of technology, you learn the power of digital, you learn the power of, oh my God, how much of the customer experience needle you can move with the technology. I was sold. I still am. Sure. I launched India's first digital savings product today. That is like the, it was the first banking product to be launched in the Aadhaar OTP guardrails. Yeah. Today, I would say that is like the framework for every digital account launching in the country. 18 months product, P&L, entire madness. We doubled the bank's customer base purely with a digital set of users.
Sure.
From there, I went to HSBC, where India was part of a 23 countrywide digital banking revamp. New mobile banking app, new internet banking, payments upgrades. You name it, we had it.
Correct. Yeah.
Now, another 18 months of that. And for some reason, they chose India as a pilot market. Maybe because it was the hardest, you know.
Also have the tech here, right?
Yeah, of course. But it was a crazy ride. At the end of all that, you reach a point of where next. Because banking somewhere felt like, okay, I've been there, done that.
Sure.
And I think in large organizations, Mushir, when you're trying to push through things, you are an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
You keep, it might not be the VCs, but it is the big bosses. You're obviously seeking sponsors, you're seeking alignment, you're bringing people together and stressing and living the life of a builder.
Yeah.
In fact, even now I say my role in Hyperface, I'm still building the same. It is just that instead of sitting inside a bank, I'm outside a bank.
Yeah.
So I think the entrepreneurial spirit was always there.
Yeah.
The bug truly bit me after my HSBC stint. Where I got lucky is in having an amazing co-founder who has built again one of the most innovative payment products. JustPay is a $600 million company.
Correct.
They are one of the world's first payment orchestration platform. So when you have somebody like that you're throwing ideas with, we both, he was building Beam UPI when I was building 811. So we've been in touch since then. And we both were consulting neobanks at the same point of time. And that's when we realized the power of embedded finance, right?
Mm-hmm.
An A16Z study says every brand will be selling a financial product.
Everything's a fintech, right? Yeah.
But the interesting part was when we both were working with neobanks, the bank checklist wasn't easy. It had a 200-pointer.
Yeah.
You be the largest of the brand, smallest of the brand, they didn't care. So we said this is where the opportunity is. This is where tech can really play a difference, and it's not being done. The second choice that we made, which I'm still happy about, is choosing credit cards. Because Mushir, again, speaking as a banker, it's very easy to talk about banking as a service and embedded finance, but banks need to see a business model. To me, co-branded credit cards is a viable pre-existing business model. Banks have been doing it for 20 years. It is just that from a logo on the card, it can totally be zoomed past using technology.
Correct. Yeah.
And credit cards is a fascinating product because I don't really think there has been so much modernization around it.
Not too much. Yeah.
Yes. I would love to say that we want to help banks and brands launch 10x better credit card programs. While we started this whole stack for brands, so many banks have come to us and said, why don't you give it for our own users? Today, Hyperface powers about 7 million customers of four banks, where we bring in the entire program orchestration layer from benefit automation to cohort-based nudging to real-time nudges and computation. How do you stitch together credit card experiences seamlessly? Today, when your bank gives you a milestone-based fee waiver, typically you don't even have a place where you can track a milestone waiver.
Correct. Yeah.
Hyperface primitives don't exist. We offer a milestone API.
Okay,
we offer a custom benefit ID API per customer. For any transaction, you can ping a Hyperface API and find out whether the customer got an applied approved cash back or a discount or not.
Yeah.
Again, learning from being in banks, 20-25% of calls in contact center for credit cards is around all this.
Yes.
Every credit card comes with loaded benefits.
Yeah.
But they are not digitized. They are not provided in a digitally intuitive way.
Yeah.
And that's where Hyperface saw the opportunity, be it brands, be it banks. Today we work with over 12 brands. We helped one of India's largest jewelry retailer launch their co-branded card with Titan, and the product offering has expanded. Embed Next is the solution where every brand can embed right within their app the entire user experience of credit card. We launched it with India's first fully travel rewards card, Ixigo. We have Onboard IQ, which has helped Titan SBI.
Okay.
Onboarding and credit cards alone has some 20 legs and 30 APIs.
Yeah.
So our orchestration engine helps banks configure new workflows, test it out super flaw.
Yeah.
So as a fintech infra player, we believe in platform, first principle based platform thinking. We believe in going API first and backwards. And lastly, we believe in modularity and how can we break components down.
Yeah.
We always say, give the Lego blocks to the user, let them build things. That has been our approach. We also have a credit line stack, which is form factor agnostic, because today it is credit card. Tomorrow in India, UPI is a rage.
Yeah.
Why can't you able to apply any everywhere real-time payment rails are the rage.
Correct.
How can I attach a lending product to that? Those are the problems we are thinking and solving for. And of course, we are building in India, but we are very clear it is for the world, because across the world, I don't think there are too many people who are doing what we do.
Not really. And I want to touch on 2-3 things here, right? Breaking it down further. One being, you didn't touch upon it, but India's credit card size, right?
Yeah.
In terms of the market, it's still very small. I think the ratio of debit cards to credit cards, 1:10, maybe, if I'm right.
Yeah.
And so still a long way to go, whereas in a vast majority of the developed world, debit cards aren't very common. You have an ATM card and then you have a credit card, right? Debit cards are even more challenging to, like, they don't do it. So there's this, that growth story on the credit card. And second is, I want your view on this, having been in finance rather, right? I was talking to Douglas Anner about it. I was like, one of the beauties of India's fintech entrepreneurs, a lot of them are not just looking outside and trying to solve a problem. And a lot of them are looking inside out because they've been there, they understand it, and they're like, let's step out and help
Share
this stuff. So do you feel that made a big difference in how you could build the product, but also engage with clients who were previous employers?
True.
How did you find that journey?
That part is not easy, Mushir. I keep joking that I'm repaying my banker karma.
Okay.
You know, it is one thing to be that fight a cat and rabble rouser in banks and getting it done, and another thing to go sell these solutions to people. But having said that, where, as you rightly said, that inside-out perspective helps. For example, in India, till we came, even when we launched, people said, you're just an orchestration, not a core. My question is, today when a bank has millions of credit cards, the core is working. What is the core supposed to do? Treasury, collection reporting, authorization. That's not what is broken. The user experience, right?
Yeah.
The management and orchestration between the multiple systems of the bank and external partners. None of that exists today. there is no customer data platform for credit cards.
Correct.
Application, yeah. Journey to transaction data to benefits data, it's all disjointed.
Yeah.
And I was very confident, having run India's first supposedly end-to-end digital program.
Yeah.
I know the gap between core systems and user experience. We're always solving it, as I call it, with batches and patches.
Yeah.
Because APIs are not available.
Still, right?
Yeah. So that is one thing I'm very convinced that the inside out helped, because I have very simple example I like to give an in. If you're an inactive customer for 30 days, today a bank cannot send you an offer on the 31st because first the data warehouse,
correct.
You have to pull the query, it goes to the marketing team, it has to be applied the necessary filters and sign off,
yeah.
And then it goes to the comms engine. Again, 31st day, customer will get the communication on 33rd day. That's where real-time orchestration platforms are super powerful, right? Just the nudges and engagement.
Yep.
While we have started with credit cards, as I told you, we want to be a modern banking platform.
Yep.
As we speak, we are working with one of our banks for the entire liability-based also.
Okay.
Why not an AMB-based nudge?
Fair. Yeah.
Why not a nudge for a UPI transaction? We are doing all that. And secondly, as you said, the opportunity in India, especially with credit cards, maybe the form factor will change. That is definitely something that we foresee, because UPI is massive.
Correct.
Second, number of banks which are offering credit cards, if you actually look at it, are just 10 to 12 with a sizable customer base.
Yes.
Right? And then in terms of market leadership, three of our top banks have about 60 mil of 103. Yeah. 60 to 70 mil, which means the opportunity is huge, and that's where the power of a modern platform will come in. Also, Mushir, I should touch upon this. The global product market for credit cards is an oligopoly. You know this better than I do.
Sure.
It is controlled by a few players and it is made very expensive.
Sif.
How do you make it really distributed, right? And that's something that's fascinating for us at Hyperface to solve for.
I'm also wanted to flip that, right? I'm in the sense, as you rightly mentioned, 10 or 12, maybe 15 banks have a credit card program. These are India's largest bank, but we have hundreds of banks, right?
Yep.
And each region, each state has 10 to 15 banks. Most states but credit itself is evolving. And as we said, not all of them are API first. They may not even have APIs. So how are you approaching that segment? Because there's this education and enablement element that comes in. And are you bringing in other partners who can be that piece for linking them to be API first, enabled, and then offering Hyperface on shop?
Absolutely. See, one thing about Indian markets is those traditional platforms have been far and few in between, and they've been enjoying massive market shares, right?
Correct, yeah.
So Break It In needs a collaborative mindset. Just yesterday, we announced a partnership with one of a premium NBFC called LoanTap.
Because yes, yeah.
To us, see, it starts with the customer getting a credit line, right? Even today in India, credit cards is a premium product. The
yes.
highest range of your CIBIL score is looked at not for a home loan but for a credit card. That's
yeah.
the reality. So what we do is we offer a very basic credit line program as well. We have a couple of clients there, and we step it up is how we are looking at it, Mushir, and from collections to fraud to
yeah.
regulatory reporting, we have partnered. In fact, we want to get to a stage of over 100 partners.
Okay.
Currently, we have about 20, 25 partners.
It's still
so
big,
as
yeah.
things get, see, that's the power of an orchestration layer. You want a fraud engine A or B, we can give it. You want a switch A, B or C, we can provide that. You want to offer an airport lounge access or a hotel or a air miles point,
yeah.
we can do that. That's the kind of configurability and modularity we want to bring in.
And as you were talking, I was thinking when you mentioned the jewelry brand and everything else, I was like, a lot of the regions, you may almost flip the model again in the sense of talking to the retailers and bringing the bank on board alongside, right? That becomes also with the Gen Z, you have a newer,
yeah.
like, you know, tie up with, you know, PlayStation or whoever, and then you come out with
interesting
products.
That you mention it, you know. When we started, people said, banks, brands, who will you target?
Yeah.
We said, we'll target both. While it looked ambitious at that time, today we are working with four banks, right? IndusInd, AU, Federal, small and mid-sized banks in
yes.
India. But couple of our largest issuers, SBI and HDFC Bank, we are integrated through our partners.
Yes.
While those banks, obviously, they are very big to work with a small player. But it is the power of what we deliver to the brands, the retailers, as you rightly said, that is taking us there.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, going back to embedded finance, there is a quadrant. I'm sure you're familiar with it. Sure. There is digital and non-digital on the other side, and there is financial and non-financial.
Yeah.
In that quadrant, the non-digital, non-financial still wants to go digital.
Yes.
Still, they want user-led solutions. So we start from there and we go all the way around.
Yeah.
There is a digital product looking for a bank from an Ixigo AU happened through the AU bank, but a Titan happened through us pitching. So I think this quadrant will keep playing. We might have to approach a different strategy, but touch it through Super.Money. We have integrated. We are integrated out of the top six. We've integrated with top four banks either directly or indirectly, right? So I think that's the power of the platform, which has that configurability. So that's how we look at it.
Okay, right. So I think the other element. We'll have that at the DCICO dropping by. The configurability is pretty important. I wanted to move a little further, just a little bit on your entrepreneurship journey. You are among some of the women founders, co-founders in Indian fintech. This is just to understand, how have you found that journey? What have been some lessons? Because you do want to encourage more women to get, there are a lot of women in finance, but not necessarily in the same scale in fintech, right? So what could they be looking at in terms of that journey, and how would you encourage them to come on board? I know it's a hard journey, right?
Yeah.
Irrespective of gender, but still.
So Mushir, when we are younger, we think gender doesn't have a role. And I still believe that when you come to the workplace, drop your gender in your mind is what I say.
Yeah.
But as you say, there is a glass ceiling for a reason, right? I mean, incidentally, Praveena just dropped by. She has been a huge inspiration. In my stint in Kotak last few months, I was reporting to her.
Okay.
There are very few women leaders to look up to, even in the corporate world, right? When I was running the P&L of the digital program, apart from me, it was the retail banking head who was managing P&L. Women do operations roles, servicing roles, who are the ones driving business, right?
Yeah.
In fintech in India, we've had great role models, right? We've had Lissy, we've had Upasana, we've had Sayali. So there has been people who have walked the path. And there is a huge amount of community and network at play, Mushir. They're all super helpful.
We have a very active founder
very group.
Close,
yes,
very close-knit,
supportive, and we all lift each other, you know. So that has been great. I'm not going to say it is easy. There is no gender, especially after working in banks where HSBC has 51% women globally,
correct.
Right?
Yeah.
You come to this world, there is definitely, you are mostly the only female in the room. But having said that, there is active support systems that you can tap into, which have been useful. Second is this, I always say that you need to be the bloody best in what you do, right?
Yeah.
I mean, any quota system works like that. It doesn't matter if you're the best, if you're at 99th percentile, you're not worried, right?
Right, yeah.
So it goes back to that, as tough as it sounds, but that's the reality.
Back your abilities and find the right support system
as such, right?
So the last part of this is, what's next? Two or three things that you want to talk about Hyperface for the next 3 years that you're looking to build or do?
Mushir, the biggest thing is in India, tapping into the credit line on UPI opportunity.
Yeah.
Every bank today, see the reality of that product is, it is something everybody is excited about, but there is no ready roadmap available.
Sure.
We want a few people to run it, maybe fail, maybe calibrate. Good. So we have a stack that allows bank to recalibrate very quickly. You know, maybe one day try out a FD-based lending line, another day do a Klarna model of pay now and do it in three parts. So that experimentation is very important and we need to find banking partners to do that. The second part definitely is expanding globally. Mushir, I'll definitely come to you.
We'll be there to support you.
See, there are India similar markets, right? Markets where credit card is there, but digital experience is what it was 5 years back here.
Correct.
Markets where credit cards are as low penetration as we are.
Yeah.
Especially SCA is a big opportunity area.
Yeah.
And of course, the crown jewel of BAS, right? USA. You want to go there sooner or later. So I would say those are our long shot goals.
I think that they're very practical and achievable goals. And I'm with your drive, that definitely should be possible. So thank you once again for joining us. It's been a pleasure, Ashwara, to have you and so much to learn and unpack. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks to Ashwarya, Hyperface co-founder and CEO. Stay tuned for more on FinStep, about GFF, about Indian fintech and the future of finance. Click like, subscribe and download and stay tuned. Thank you.